it says, pick Jesus. So I thought that was rather clever. So let's begin by prayer. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, Lord, we thank you that all things are in your hands, Lord. And Lord, we do want to hear from you. And we do want to communicate with you, and we do want to choose you. Because this is the most important thing that we will do in our lives. And Lord, we want to do it. Lord, you know how flawed we are. And you don't try to hide that in the Bible. No, you don't try to hide it at all. So many books during that period, they're public relations books, only about how great men were in winning battles and this and that. But the Bible tells it the way it is. With all the ugliness and all the beauty, that is mankind. And so, Lord, I thank you and I praise you for choosing us. And I pray that we would choose you. In Yeshua's name we pray. So maybe the biggest decision that you make in your lifetime, God's will or your will? We used to say in the older days, thy will or my will? Same thing. Who are you going to follow? This is the most important thing in life. This is the direction of your life. And you have to make that decision every day to follow God. And sometimes you have to make it several times a day. Because the enemy does not want you to choose yourself. He does not want you to choose my will. And he throws a lot of energy in there. The flesh is very strong. Very, very strong. And he does not want you to choose God. How strong is it? Even Yeshua was challenged by us. Let's deal with this issue as Yeshua dealt with it. And he had to deal with it not once by choosing God, not twice, but three times. Matthew 26, 39, 42, 44. And going a little further, Yeshua fell on his face and prayed, saying, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Again, for the second time, he went away and prayed, my Father, if this cannot pass, unless I drink it, your will be done. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Choosing thy will, thy will, thy will. It was hard. And if it was hard for him, you can imagine what it's like for you and I. And the disciples who were with him, forget about it. They were a total failure. They didn't sleep the first time only. They didn't sleep the second time only. They didn't sleep the third time only. They simply couldn't pray. They were sleeping. I don't know, is there? I know I've heard of sleepwalking, but I never heard of sleep praying. Maybe I don't know. Sleeping. They were escaping. They were running. They didn't want to deal with the situation that was before them. The flesh is indeed weak. And they're not the only ones that are sleeping. And they're not the only ones that are trying to escape. And they're not the only ones that are trying to run away from some situation. His disciples didn't want to hear that Yeshua was sleeping. They slept. They couldn't handle it. They just couldn't handle it. And there's many times in the Bibles that those difficult times are there for people. Some of them crack. Some of them don't. But the thing that's fascinated me in recent years, recent weeks, is a prophet, yes, a prophet called Jonah. Jonah has a fascinating story to tell not only us, but himself and every generation from Jonah on. Jonah was a prophet. Maybe you don't think he really needed to be a prophet. Maybe you don't think he deserved to be a prophet. But God said he was a prophet. Yeshua said he was a prophet. Therefore, he was a prophet. But in his first act, in his first chapter, he denies God's will and chooses his own. Astonishing that a Hebrew prophet would publicly go and defy God's will. The Lord commanded him to go to Nineveh. So what did he do? He went the opposite way. He bought a ticket to Tarshish. Go in the absolute opposite direction. Fleeing from the Lord. Jonah 1:1-3. And we'll return to this as well. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me." And you have every expectation that he would go to Nineveh. But the author shocks us. But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish. From the presence of the Lord, he went down to Joppa and found the ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. Imagine this, a Hebrew prophet running away from the presence of the Lord. Why? Why did he do this? Well, let's see if we can answer that as we go along. So the next thing that's happening in this chapter is that the Lord caused this huge storm. And where are you going to escape on a ship? What can you do? You can't, there's no escape. You can go to the bottom of the ship. But actually, that's the first place where you're drowned. There's no escape. And he was found in a deep, deep sleep. Now he really needed to escape. And that's the only avenue that he had open to him, was to sleep, was to try to escape, because everything is out of his control. At this point, everything is out of control. He can't do a thing. I don't know if you've ever been on a ship during a storm, but it's terrifying. My father actually brought my brother and I on this party boat off of Cape Cod the day after the hurricane. Well, nobody told my father that it was still hurricane type weather. And we were rocking, smashing into the waves. The water was coming over on each direction. We were drenched, and the water was cold. And I was holding on for dear life on the railing of the ship. And I was bait for all the fish in the water, because I was vomiting. Whatever I had eaten, at least in the last week, was coming out. And the fish came up to feed. Well, my father never took us fishing after that. We couldn't even go by land. But anyhow, back to Jonah. Jonah's our star today. You're thinking, Jeff, you must be mistaken. No Hebrew prophet would do this. And you're right, no other prophet really defied the Lord like this time. Nobody. But he was a prophet. Let's look again at that Jonah 1:1-3. Okay? It starts with something groundbreaking. The word of the Lord. You will never see that as an introduction to any prophetic book. Never. Only here, where the author puts it straight out, he's breaking ground. He's breaking the rules. This is in fact, this is the word of the Lord that he is breaking. Never in any other book will you find it starting. You'll find it in the books. It'll be during different topics, in different sections, but it'll never even start a section. The word of the Lord. In fact, the Lord's commanding Jonah to go to Nineveh. He didn't. God's word. But Jonah went the other way. How come? What could he possibly be thinking? What could Jonah possibly be thinking? That this was only a local God? No. Judaism never believed in a local God. But always, always a universal God. So, what are you going to say? That Tarshish was outside of Yeshua's jurisdiction? That's ridiculous. He knows everything. The world. The galaxies. So the question is it possible to escape? Is it possible to escape the Lord? According to Psalm 139, it is not. Let's do 5, 7, and 10. You hem me in, behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. Look, the whole situation here is a setup for Jonah. Jonah is being tested. And it could be that you and I are to be tested by reading Jonah, by understanding what happened to Jonah. Jonah was a Hebrew prophet. He was not a nobody. Jonah had a choice when he was there. Is he going to go to Tarshish? Or is he going to go to Nineveh? We all make these decisions. Who are we going to follow? Are we going to follow God? Or are we going to follow our own will? Everything's from the Lord. If you look at this book of John, everything is from the Lord. Let's go to John 1:7. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. The Lord appointed. It was the Lord that did this. Jonah 2:3. For you cast me into the deep, you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. You cast me into the deep. John 3b. All your ways and your billows passed over me. All your breakers, all your billows, they're all yours. Every single thing that is happening is under God's control. Jonah picked his own destiny. And he's going to be living it. Up with its ups and downs. You may not know this, but the author of Jonah was a psalmist. Yes, right in the middle of the book of Jonah. He wrote a psalm. Jonah 2:9. 2:2-9. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish, saying, I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my cry, for you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas. And the flood surrounded me, all your waves and all your billows passed over me. Next slide. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight, yet I shall again look upon your holy temple. The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. At the roots of the mountains, I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought me up, my life from the pit, O Lord, my God. Next slide. When my life was fading away, I remembered the Lord. And my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love. But I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. When I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And what would a Hebrew prophet vow? He would vow his total surrender to the Lord. Are we seeing that in Jonah's life? Not yet. Will we see it? Well, yes. And no. One of the amazing things about this psalmist and this writer, he must have known very deeply and very intimately about Psalm 139. So let's take a look at Psalm 139. And its parallels with Jonah. Psalm 139:5. You hem me in behind and before, and will you lay your hand upon me. From Jonah. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. You think he was hemmed in the body, in the belly of the fish? Yes. Absolutely, he was hemmed in. Psalm 139:7 and Jonah 2:6. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? Jonah, I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought my life from the pit, O Lord. My God. And finally, Psalm 139:8, Jonah 2:2. If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. Jonah. I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me out of the belly of Sheol. I cried. And you heard my voice. Here is Jonah enclosed in the belly. He can't flee anymore. He's right where God wants him. One commentator thinks that the fish actually vomited up Jonah on the beach on the way to Nineveh. So he didn't need a GPS or anything. So for Jonah, it took a death or a near-death experience for Jonah to pray. Some people believe that he died and he went to Sheol. And other people say no. Sheol, it doesn't always mean a place of death. So you can understand why the commentators would say both. But he prayed, and he was praying earnestly for his life. Was he going to choose God? As well, was he going to choose his own will? God had him cornered. Had him absolutely cornered here. Jonah 2:9. But I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. The test continues for Jonah. He's still there. And he's praying all these things, and I'm sure they're from his heart. He's a prophet. But words itself can be meaningless. And we may find that with him. Because you've got to back that up with deeds. You've got to back that up with deeds. How many times will people say, yeah, I'll meet you here, I'll meet you there, I'll do this, I'll do that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Until they show up. How many people do you know that actually keep their appointments? I would say a decreasing amount. Let's see what James has to say about it. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from works. And I will show you my faith by my works. So what are we choosing? Are we choosing God's will? Or are we choosing my will? We've got to do it. Every day. Every day. And with no additions. It's not changing God's words to suit your own situation. There is a story about a pastor who is discipling a young man. This young man loved the Bible and kept on reading it and reading it and studying it, and he wanted to be a pastor. And he kept on being an excellent, excellent student. And one day he asked to see the pastor. And it was urgent. And so the pastor saw him. And for the next hour, he was telling the pastor, the Bible? I don't believe a word. It's not scientific. It's not this. It's not that. No. It's none of the things that you've been telling me. And the pastor, he's just sitting there calmly. As if they were talking about which tea they liked. The pastor says, are you finished? The young man said, yes. So just answer me one question. He says, okay. He said, when did you start sleeping with your girlfriend? The boy's jaw dropped open. How did the pastor know? It didn't suit him anymore. He had to change. He had to change what the Bible said or dismiss the Bible. And he did. He did. God's will or your will. If you're looking to edit the Bible towards what is good for you, that's called your will. It's not his will. It's your will. He tells us what he wants, and then you have a decision. You're going to follow him, or you're not going to follow him. So let's return to this story of Jonah, because the author in this story continues to build parallels. And he does this to heighten pieces of this text. And you may be sick of this, but let's go back to Jonah 1 and compare it. Compare it to the same book just two chapters later and see what happens. John 1, 1 and 2. Oh, Jonah, yeah. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. Surely they were evil. John 3.
Jonah.
Right. Thanks, son. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you. Jonah changed his mind. God never changed his mind. Look at the imperative verbs here. He does two. Arise and go. They're both imperative. It's a command. Arise. Get up. Go. Go where? Go to Nineveh. He repeats it because the same words act as emphasis, act in highlighting what he's doing. Jonah's response is now different. Let's go to the next slide. Jonah 1:3. But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish away from the presence of the Lord. Jonah 3:3a. So Jonah rose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Same thing. Different response. Imperatives. You go with an immediacy now. Jonah's response absolutely, radically changes. God's response, steadfast. God remains the same. Because us as humans, we're very fickle. Our hearts change, our minds change, our wills change. We're subject to emotions. We're subject to anxiety. We're subject to depression. God's heart remains the same. Arise. Go. Go to Nineveh. What does God want from Jonah? What does he want from you? What does he want from me? He wants us to choose and follow his will. To choose and follow his will. For Jonah, in this test, obedience. Yes. Proclaiming God's name. Repentance. Servanthood. God gave Jonah a second chance. Actually more. And he's actually given you and I second chances. And third. And fourth. For me, we're in double digits. And maybe for you as well. So back to Jonah. So Jonah started proclaiming the word. He got to Nineveh. He did what he was supposed to do. He listened to the Lord. He listened to his will. He was wildly successful. He could be the greatest evangelist of all time. 120,000, as far as we can see, gave their heart to the Lord. You'd think he'd be throwing a party. He's angry. Absolutely angry at the Lord's success. At the Lord using him. Jonah 3:4. All right, so we'll go through it all. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." That's his message. It seems like it's his whole message. In Hebrew, it's even shorter. It's 5 words. This is what he did. Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. That's the message. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least of them. They repented. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, sat in ashes. Next slide. And the king issued a proclamation and published through Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. They're fasting. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish. They repented. These violent, violent people. Actually, they are in the top three of the most barbarous people on the face of the planet of all times. They made the Romans look like humanitarians. They were ugly. They were violent and vicious. But the people of Nineveh chose God. They chose God's will. And who would have expected the Ninevites to repent? Then again, who would expect the Hebrew prophet to run from God's commands? The Jonah of chapter 4, when Jonah absolutely is angry at God and lets him know, reverts back to the Jonah of chapter 1, defiant. He had forgotten what God had done for him. Don't we all? Don't we forget what God has done for us? Jonah did. And that ugly head of my will was back. Back in Jonah. Jonah 4, 1 and 2. Okay, let's skip that slide and go to Jonah 4, 1 and 2. But it pleased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. For I knew that you are gracious, you are a gracious God, and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relenting from disaster." What's he telling? What's he telling God here? "I told you so." Can you imagine this? Can you imagine that this is really what he's saying? And what about the rest? "For I knew that you're a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love." You would think that would be a blessing. He hates it. He hates it. He hates what God has done. He goes back into this selfish state of mind with this prayer. Jonah 4, 2 and 3. And he prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me. It's better for me to die than to live. You think he's a little emotional here? You think he's a little over the top here? Whose will is he choosing? In his selfish state of mind, we choose our will. We're self-absorbed with our own thoughts, our own actions. We choose our will. When we're like this, it's all about me. But really what we're doing is we're robbing ourselves from God. And all the beautiful things that God has for us, we are robbing them. We are robbing them. God is so much bigger, so much greater than we can possibly imagine. But we must choose Him. We must choose His will. He doesn't force us to. Doesn't force us to at all. My will is a short-sighted will. My will leads to disappointment. It leads to anger. Especially when God doesn't go according to our will. Jonah expected him. Kept on holding out, thinking that God would change his mind and realize that these are vicious, violent people. And that he should never have done this. I told you so. I told you that you were gracious, that you were compassionate, that you would relent. That's why I ran away. I didn't want to experience this. These people are killers. And yes, they did take over Israel. And yes, except for Jerusalem, yes. They did take over. And thousands of Jews were slaughtered. My will? What did I know? Jonah is complaining. He's complaining about the graciousness and compassion of God. I don't know where you find it. I don't know where else you find it. My will is a very fickle thing. Look at Jonah. He fled from the Lord in chapter 1. In chapter 2, he praised the Lord for saving his life. In chapter 4, he begs the Lord to take his life. Because he didn't get what he wanted. In chapter 3, he obeyed God's command. And in chapter 4, he wished he didn't. He was all over the place. All over the place. And so can we rely on ourselves? Can we rely on our emotions? Can we rely on the limited view of this world? Or do we notice that we vacillate wildly? We swing wildly. Well, that's what my will is all about. Look what happened to Jonah and his warped view of reality. His warped view of reality. He was so angry, he stormed out of Nineveh, built a shelter for himself, then God supplied this huge vine. And the vine shaded him. It says that God prepares a plant. And then God provides a worm. And the worm eats the plant. Jonah 4:6. Now the Lord God appointed a plant and made it come up over Jonah. that it might be a shade over his head to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plant. Actually, it's the only time in the whole book that it said that Jonah was happy, that he was glad. He was prayerful. He was thankful. He was defiant. But he was never happy until he got this plant. But that didn't last, did it? It didn't last at all. He praises God, and then he blames God. He runs from God and tells him he's sorry that he ran from God. He's all over the place. Now, what is it about this plant? It's his personal comfort. How are we doing with personal comfort? When we're not in our personal comfort zone, what happens? It becomes my world, doesn't it? At least for a lot of us, it does. God prepared the plant. God prepared the worm. Jonah's reaction? He wants to die. That's it. He's had it. And God exposes his value system. And his value system is this. Jonah had more compassion on a plant than 120,000 people that were saved in Nineveh. That's my will. My will of personal comfort. 4:10-11. And the Lord said, you pity the plant, for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, the great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons, who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle? So the way the author has this is he puts the stress on you and I. So we're saying like this. And the Lord said, you pity the plant. But he says, and should I pity Nineveh? And yes, they're his creation, his absolute creation. Jonah is an example to us not to be self-absorbed, not to be in our own will. Listen, realizing God knows far more than we do. He's got a bigger plan. Jonah didn't understand his plan. He still doesn't understand his plan. Many of us want to stay in the safety of our cocoon. God wants us out. God wants us out of his cocoon. Of our cocoon. He wants us to go out there and proclaim his name. He wants us to love other people. He wants us to serve other people. He wants us to follow him. He wants us to choose the Lord and follow him. And this last piece on Jonah 4, look, there's no conclusion to the book. The book ends in a question. It's astonishing. God doesn't provide us with an answer. Maybe he was looking for you and I to draw our own conclusions and then follow that conclusion. Thy will, God. God's will or my will? It's all a contrast here at the end. The contrast is between God's will and my will. Deuteronomy 30, 19. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, choose me, choose my will, that you and your offspring may live. The question is there for you and I every day. My will or his will? And sometimes it's not easy. It wasn't easy for Yeshua himself. It wasn't easy for Jonah. But we're going to find more about Jonah in the coming weeks. Because Jonah has a lot to tell us about our lives. Let's pray. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, Lord, we thank you. Thank you for the book of Jonah. Thank you that Jonah made mistakes, because we do as well. Thank you that you tested Jonah. Thank you, because we know at some point he came back. And he was and is a Hebrew prophet. Lord, bless us with wisdom and discernment to follow you in all we do. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen.
Yevarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'yichuneka. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yasem lecha shalom.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.